When a victim comes in to report an assault, it's not uncommon that she or he would have to describe the assault multiple times in excruciating detail. And from the victim's point of view, this is usually being done within the first 24, 48, sometimes 72 hours after the assault. The trauma is still very fresh. So talking about it is emotionally very difficult. And how that can behaviorally manifest is that the story can come out in bits and pieces and fits and starts and cycle back over on itself, or, oh, wait a minute, I remembered this detail. It comes out in a very disorganized way. And for law enforcement, they take those stops and starts and cycle backs as suspicious. Why isn't she talking in the way that she should? Why isn't this a nice linear progression of this is what happened and this is what happened and this is what happened? So what they then do is they start going back over the story again and again and again and trying to hone in on more details, which is very, very difficult for victims. So what this whole experience is like for victims is trying to tell the story over and over again, and it becomes, for many survivors, a second assault. And I refer to this as secondary victimization, that sexual assault victims are having to relive the assault, and the way they are treated by the criminal justice system is disempowering, it's victim blaming, and it feels like they're being raped all over again. They have to explain, why were you here? What were you wearing? What did you do to provoke the assault? It's about proving that she's been raped rather than trying to get an account of a crime that they would then investigate as they would any other crime. So for most victims, it's a very harrowing experience that leaves them feeling blamed, depressed, anxious, and reluctant to seek further help. So for a lot of victims, the first contact with the criminal justice system is the only contact they have with the criminal justice system. Either they say, never mind, forget it, I can't do this, or the police have interpreted her behavior as so suspicious that they close the case before any investigation ever takes place. What I've done in my research is compare victims' health and well-being, psychological health and physical health, for those who reported the assault to the criminal justice system and those who don't. And unfortunately, the results are exactly what none of us would want, which is victims who go to the criminal justice system and have these kind of secondary victimization behaviors, their mental health outcomes are worse. We see significantly higher post-traumatic stress symptoms. We see higher physical health symptomatology, headaches, gastrointestinal problems, gynecological and urinary tract infections. And again, it's not that the criminal justice system causes that, it causes the distress, and the PTSD is the gateway into a lot of negative health consequences. So yeah, when victims report to the criminal justice system, it doesn't go well. It has a very severe psychological impact that in turn can affect their long-term physical health and well-being. I think what I'm hoping to do in this talk today, and what I hope to do in my training with law enforcement, is bring what I know from psychology about victim behavior into their investigational practice. And when they start with that assumption of what the victim says doesn't make sense, to bring the social science data to bear to challenge that assumption, to say, wait a minute, no. I remember now from this training that the neurobiology of trauma will cause victims to have very unusual, sometimes very unstable emotions. Some of them will be high and then low, some of them will be very flat. And that doesn't mean she's lying, it means she has all of this different hormonal response going on. And I hope that from this presentation, law enforcement and other first responders would now understand the neurobiology of memory. And that when you ask a victim to recall the events of the assault, it's going to be very difficult to do because of the way the memory of the assault has been stored throughout the brain. That the victim has to go here and here and here and here and glue it all together, and that takes time. So when they see the victim stumble or have difficulty piecing it together, it doesn't mean she's lying or making it up as she's going along. She's really having difficulty pulling together the pieces of a traumatic memory and putting it in order. So little things like that aren't little things at all. They're huge things that would, I think, really change and challenge the way law enforcement think about victims and know that their primary role in that initial interview sometimes is just to sit back, give her the time, give her the space, let it unfold, and have the patience to have it come together.